So today, we're going to try to tackle love. How many love love? Who loves love, right? I love love. Well, according to a recent statistic, and in this one particular one is off a thing called Statistic Brain, and it says this: the average annual Valentine's Day spending, all right, is over $13 billion for a Hallmark holiday. Come on, can I get a witness, right? $13 billion spent on Valentine's Day. Listen to this. There are 180 million Valentine's Day cards that's going to go out this year. 180, I mean, how many are going to be a recipient of one of those cards? At least you think you are, right? Oh, we got a few of them. You're not expecting nothing around here. Yeah, well, he don't give me nothing, right? Right? 189 million roses will be grown for Valentine's Day this year. 198 million. Listen to this one. 85% of women bought Valentine's Day card. That seems pretty good, right? 73% of all flowers were purchased by men. How many is that true? How many is in that percentage? Right? Okay? All right? Here's one for you. I found this funny. 14% of women bought flowers for themselves. Oh, you did? Oh, my goodness. You're in the percentage you made it in. Yes, yes, yes. Good for you. Hey, I'm not saying nothing. Yeah, okay. So, listen to this. The average consumer spends $116.21 on Valentine's Day. The average. The average. That's crazy. Who does that, right? Who does that? All right? It's going to be you when you get older, I'm telling you that right now, right? 61.8% of consumers who actually celebrate Valentine's Day, right? And here's one, and everyone needs to pay attention to this one because this one is over the top. 53% of women said they're going to end their relationship if they don't get something. 53%! All right? Loving love. And we go out of our way for our significant other, and we go out of our way for our spouse, and we spend money, and we buy flowers, and we buy candy, and it has to be dark chocolate, not the other stuff. How many know what I'm talking about, all right? How many like the chocolate-covered potato chips from Esther Price? Who doesn't like those? Raise your hand. Oh, wow. I'm a little shocked at that. All right, all right. I don't care for chocolate, so, you know, just give me the potato chips, right? But we're gonna go to a passage of Scripture that is rarely used in the church today. And so I want you to grab your copy of God's Word, and I'd like for you to turn to Song of Songs. Now, this is going to make some people nervous in church. Can I say, that's all right, that's all right. I'm going to make some people nervous, and you're going to get the sweats, and all of a sudden it's like, Pastor, this is just making me feel weird. You know what, just stick with me, all right? Song of Songs, chapter 5. And I'll be reading out of the New Living Translation for this particular passage of Scripture. And it says this, the young man, I have entered my garden, my treasure, my bride. I gather myrrh with my spices and eat honeycomb with you, my honey. I drink wine with my milk. Young women of Jerusalem, O lover and beloved, eat and drink, yes, drink deeply of your love. Young woman, I slept. It kind of sounds like a little Shakespearean thing going right here, right? Young woman, I slept, but my heart was awake. When I heard my lover knocking and calling, open to me, my treasure, my darling, my dove, my perfect one. My head is drenched with dew, my hair with dampness of the night. But I responded, I have already taken off my robe. Should I get dressed again? I've washed my feet. Should I get them soiled? My lover tried to unlatch the door, and my heart thrilled within me. I jumped up to open the door for my love, and my hands dripped with perfume. My fingers dripped with lovely myrrh as I pulled back the bolt. I opened to my lover, but he was gone, and my heart sank. I searched for him, but could not find him anywhere. I called to him, but there was no reply. Father, I'm asking that you give me the words that you spoke into my heart this week. Lord, we have got to understand what love is really all about. And I'm asking, oh God, that you would give us revelation through your word that we would forever be changed. Lord, help us. Help me. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Amen and amen. So here we see somewhat of a romance. We see interaction between really the king and his bride. We see, as this writing goes on, we can see a romantic picture taking place here. Now, through the years and as you begin to study the scriptures, there will be those that think that this particular passage of scripture has a double meaning to it. And some people, when they study Song of Songs, they almost think that it can be somewhat dirty. Can I tell you, God doesn't do dirty stuff. God does not have that in him. What we are seeing here is a picture of a romance between a man and a woman, but you also see a picture of a relationship between God and his people, God and his church. And what we see is the bridegroom coming and knocking and saying, hey, come in, I want to be with you. I want to have relationship with you. And instead of this being something that is totally depicted of something that is sexual, what we've got to understand is that God is calling out for his people because he wants to show us his love as his people. He wants us to know what true love is all about, because in the world that we live in, love has been perverted, love has been distorted, and instead of love, what we have is we have this lust factor that is going on. Instead of love, it is lust. And that's where we get all of these ideas that of we can have relations before we are married. And you can see all kinds of different perversion that's going on in this world. Well, as long as I'm happy, as long as I'm not hurting anyone, everything is fine. But that's not God's way. That's the perverted way. That is the way the world thinks. And here in the scriptures, we see an incredible picture of how God the Father can come in and knock on the door of our heart and say, come in, I want to be with you. And as a man, sometimes that can get twisted, and sometimes that, like, what? What are you talking about? You see, intimacy with Christ cannot be based upon how you were raised. Hello? Intimacy with Christ has to be based upon your relationship with him. And see, when we have that personal relationship with Christ, that perversion stuff just seems to fade away and go out the window. So when we look at this, this is not merely just about an interaction between a man and a woman. And a man came in, the king came in, and there was romance involved, and you can kind of see the mood is being set. But we're not going that direction this morning, because what we really want to look at is the condition of the heart. I want you to look at this, go back to this again. You can see the man, he's coming in, she's heard her lover, he's knocking and he's calling her name. And then we see this thing that happens in verse 3. But I respond to this. I respond to my name being called. I respond to the one who my heart loves. And my response is, you know what? I've already taken off my robe. I've already washed my feet. You know, I've already, am I supposed to get dressed again? Should I get them soiled? And God keeps, and you can see this, God keeps calling and God keeps trying to draw in. But now we're giving excuses of why we can't go meet with the Lord. Everybody with me here? Have we made the change from the awkwardness? Now we've made the switch. Let's get over that now. Look at your name and say, get over it. All right? Let's enter into what this is all about. You see, God came calling. As he does every single day of every single moment of every single second, he's calling us and he's trying to draw us into himself. But many times we are constantly too busy. We've already got stuff on, we already got stuff I got to do, and we've already got our agenda, and we give him excuses just as this woman gave excuses. Man, I've already taken my robe off, God. God, I already spent enough time at the altar. Why do I need to go back? I already came up during worship and I got my cry out. Why do I need to go back again? And God continues to call and to call and to call. But here's the scary part of it. The woman went to the door. And many times we respond to the moving of the Holy Spirit. But what we don't realize, the opportunity of a lifetime must be taken within the lifetime of the opportunity. Did someone hear that? The opportunity of a lifetime has got to be seized, has got to be taken hold of within the lifetime, that window of opportunity. So when God is calling, you know when the Holy Spirit is calling you and drawing you in. You know what he's doing, but many times we're too busy to stop what we're doing and to listen to him. And God has given us a window, but God, I'm busy. Should I get up and wash my feet again? Should I get my, should I've already taken off my robe. God, I'm already set. I'm already set in my ways. God, thank you. Should I put on more perfume? Should I do that? You see, the woman got up, but she gave too many excuses. And then by the time she got to the door, he was gone. And if we're not careful, the same thing can happen to us when the Holy Spirit is moving in church. You know, the Holy Spirit can move outside of church too. If we're not careful, when we're reading the word and we're seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these things are being added, if we're not careful, that moment that God is trying to do, we give all the excuses. If we're not careful, he'll move on. He'll move on. You'll read, if you want to read later, you can read, she went out, the lover was gone, and then she went out in the streets looking, and then she got beaten. Let me tell you something. That is a perfect picture of when we don't respond to God, the enemy can come in. Hello? The enemy can come in and we can take a whooping. Hello? A theologian by the name of Daniel Estes, he's from Cedarville University. I found this very interesting. He said this: her problem was that she didn't go to the door. That was not the problem. But that she did it so slowly and reluctantly, making excuses all along the way. This attitude shows an insensitive spirit. Remember what I talked about, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, that the Bible is very specific, that he tells us that if we will resist the devil, he will flee from us. Well, many times if we're not careful, that word can be used in resisting the Holy Spirit. And when he's calling us and he's trying to draw us in, and we've had a bad day. I had a bad day, right? We got that thing going on. I got a bad day, and God, I don't want to worship you. Stuff is going on, and I come into church, and I just, right? We miss it. And guess what? We've all missed it. We're not talking about salvation here, guys. I want you to understand that. We're not talking about salvation here. We're talking about a refreshing and a moving of the Spirit on your life that He wants to fill you. Remember how the Bible says that freely I've received and freely I give? Well, you can't give something if you don't have it. And God desires to fill us to overflowing. But many times we get so satisfied with the waiter and the waitress at the glass. Would you like some more tea? Would you like some more water? And right here, was that enough? Is that enough? And when it gets closer to the top, we get a little nervous. We do. We get a little nervous. And all of a sudden they're like, oh, they get nervous. Because they don't want it to spill out on the table and get all over you. Friends, God wants to pour into us to where it's overflowing. But we've got to respond to Him in order for that to happen. And this is where the love factor truly comes in. You see, there was an issue with this gal's heart. There's an issue with this gal's heart. Something was going on. In Acts chapter 7, verse 51, it says, "You stubborn people, you are heathen at heart and deaf to the truth. Must you forever resist the Holy Spirit like your fathers did?" And so you're doing the same thing. G. Lloyd Carr said this. Often it is found in songs of mourning and lamentation, and here reflects a perpetual unwillingness to act rather than the impossibility of action. It wasn't an impossibility. When we're in the presence, just like even he's here right now, we find ourselves making a choice to respond or act at any moment. To even right now, the Holy Spirit is speaking to someone. You can either take that and receive it, or you can push that to the side. It's not an impossibility of action, that it can't happen. It's just an unwillingness to act. She appears to be unwilling to put herself to any trouble, even for her lover. And if we're not careful, that can be the same thing with our Lord. It can be the same thing. This is where the love factor really comes in. And I want to share just a few love factor facts with you. All right? Say that really quick. All right? Love factor facts. And say that 20 times, okay? Really fast, okay? Don't do that right now. Do it later, all right, during lunch. Love factor facts. And some of you are going to laugh at this because this is a DC talk thing. How many DC talk people do we have in the place, all right? Love is a verb, right? Love is a verb. What's a verb? Someone tell me. Action. It's an action word. In Galatians chapter 5, we will see that Galatians chapter 5, verse 13, it says this: "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love." It's an action, Katrina. It's something that we do. Serve one another humbly in love. "For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command." Everybody say love.
Love.
"Your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh." You see, I believe the issue that the woman had was a love issue. A momentary lapse in selfishness and judgment can cause love to diminish. Many times we can see this through the words of our mouth. When you are in the heat of a situation and you're frustrated, or Rod, you're angry, and then all of a sudden you just say something. It's like venom that just comes. How many do you have no idea what I'm talking about, right? I don't know. Ask someone else, right? in that momentary lapse of judgment, it's not love that's coming forth from your mouth. It's hatefulness. It's the silver bullet to kill the werewolf of our souls, right? It's something, and sometimes, and I will tell you this, sometimes we sit with the silver bullet loaded and ready to go, right? And can I tell you, I've lived that way before. Because whenever you're in an argument, whenever you're in a situation, you will always walk away saying, if I would have only said this, if I'd have said that, man, that would have destroyed, that would have just, how many know what I'm talking about? It's one of the things, you're not operating in love, you're operating in self-preservation, you're operating in pride, you're operating in just anger, in disgust, and that's not what God has called us to do. It says this, if you bite and devour each other, watch out, because you'll be destroyed by one another. And in the church, if we're not careful, if we're not responding like this gal, God is calling. Even in this church, the Holy Spirit is calling. He's trying to get our attention. If we're not careful, you can be in the awesome presence of God and still not have any love. You see, love is a verb. It is an action word. It's something that has got to be not just said. It's got to be done by our actions. It's okay to say it, but our actions have got to line up with that. It's a love factor fact. Love is a verb. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 and 6, it says, as a prisoner of the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling for you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing one another in love. And this is the next one. Make every effort. When's the last time you've made every effort? Well, I did that once before, Pastor. I did it once before, and they just did this. And you know what God says? This is what you're doing, and this is what I want you to do. Someone got that? Sometimes we get so full of ourselves, and we don't even know what we're saying. But can I tell you, we do know what we're saying, because the Holy Spirit spoke through the Word. It says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So are you speaking love or are you speaking something else? You see, y'all thought I was talking about marriage today. Well, wrong, right? Bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, one Father of all, who is over and through all and in all. Ephesians 4, John chapter 14, it says this, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me, listen, and here's the key, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done. What did Jesus do? He loved people and he had compassion on people. Well, Pastor, I do. I want to see people healed. I want to see marriages restored. I want to see all these different things. Well, sure, we want to see those things. But we've got to be first to have love flowing through our veins, loving people to life. But you don't understand. They wear that perfume I don't like, and you don't understand. And they just looked at me, cross-eyed pastor, and you don't understand what they said. You should have saw what they wrote on Facebook. It wasn't even to you anyway. I think they were talking about me. Some of you are going to get that here in a second. Jesus said this, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works because I'm going to be with the Father. And see, we like this verse, the second half of it in verse 13. You can ask for anything in my name. Oh, we love it. We love it. We quote it. We know it. You can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it so the Son can bring glory to the Father. Yes, ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. We love that. It's an awesome verse. It's a promise verse. Jesus said it. But we skip the beginning and we skip the end. We skip the beginning. Anyone who believes in me will do the same works I've done. Jesus loved people. People spit in his face. People gave him a whooping. People falsely accused him. See, we don't like that stuff. Well, but Jesus, hold up. Time out. You see, when we start talking about that, we don't like to roll over when people are eating us for lunch. We want to defend ourselves. We want to defend ourselves. But God, let me tell you something. Jesus loved people to life instead of loving them to death. He loved them to life. That's the way people are going to come to know him, is to love him. Love that permeates from our very being. People will know if you genuinely care for them. People will know. And it will be expressed by what we do. Number two, love factor facts. True love is unconditional. In Mark chapter 10, and I love this, how it reads in the NASB. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up to him and knelt before him. This is Jesus. And asked him, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit? How many know what I'm talking about? The rich young ruler. To inherit eternal life. And Jesus said to him, why in the world do you call me good? There's no one good except for God alone. Well, you know the commandments. Remember, he's talking with him. He's got relationship with this guy. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Don't defraud. Honor your father and mother. And he said to him, teacher, I have kept all these things from my youth up. And this is why I love this verse. Looking at him, did we have this? There we go, NASB. Looking at him, Jesus felt a love for him and said, he had a love for him. It was unconditional. And here's where the unconditional comes in. Read on. One thing you lack. I want you to go and sell all your possessions and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. But at these words, he was saddened, and he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property. And I believe it was in the King James Version. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Here it is. Here's the key. Jesus had a love for him. And not only did he have a love for him, Jesus invited him, I want you to come and follow me. He invited him to be one of his disciples. He didn't do that for everybody. The man who was demon-possessed, that was running all crazy, half-naked through the tombs, and everyone would try to bind him. He would break the shackles, break the chains. He was a madman. No, he came and fell at Jesus' feet. Jesus cast the demon out of him. This guy had an incredible testimony. He was set free. Jesus cared for this man, but Jesus didn't ask him to follow him. He said, oh, let me follow you. Jesus said, no, I want you to go home, and I want to let your testimony be over there. He didn't invite him to be one of his disciples. This guy right here, the rich young ruler, Jesus knew that he was going to shut him down, but he loved him and he invited him in anyway. How many people would you invite in if you knew that they were going to give you a bad, no thanks. They're going to continue to, see, the love of God, true love, is unconditional. The difference is we have conditions on our love. Don't we? We've got term limits. We've got term limits on how we love and who we love. And, well, if you do this, and I'm not going to love you. And we've got exceptions to the rule, everything. We've got our contracts written all out. Anybody with me? You see, the love factor fact is true love is unconditional. I love the old hymn called The Love of God. It says this, the love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the greatest star and reaches down to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care, God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. You see, the love of God is far beyond what we can ever imagine. It's unconditional. Because if God's love had conditions on it, you and I would have been cut off a long time ago. I mean, for real. If that was the truth, we would have been cut off a long time ago. Because half of us in this room, we're the captain of the dirty underwear gang, right? I mean, come on. Let's just be for real. We've got stains, we've got blemishes, we've got wrinkles. And what does the Bible say? He's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle. And here we are, we're trying to iron out all this stuff and we're getting burned because it's too hot. How many have ever done that before? Tried to iron a pair of clothes when it's on you? Don't ever do it. You will get a suntan instantaneously, and it won't go away for about a month and a half. You see all the little holes in there and everything? That was with the steam part, too. Right? But it got the wrinkle out, all right? That's all that matters. You see, we try to iron all these things out, and we've got to rely upon the precious blood of Jesus Christ that takes away our sins. When he comes back for a church without spot or wrinkle, when he's coming back for us, the bride, that doesn't mean that we're perfect. That means we're covered by the blood. And it means that we're in right relationship or right love affair of him, that when he calls upon us, we answer. Hello? I hope somebody's with me here today. John 3:16, I love it. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have what? Everlasting life. God so loved. If you want to learn how to love, don't even look towards your mom and dad. Lori's reading this book, and I'm waiting to get my hands on it. It's called God Distorted. And basically the gist of it is we view God and we place God in a place that we view other people. So when we look at our own earthly fathers and when we look at our own mothers and we put relationship on and people have hurt us, how many have ever been hurt by someone? Absolutely. You've been hurt in many times, especially me as a father. When my dad left when I was 2 years old, there was pain, there's agony. I didn't meet him till I was 20 years old. And there was all kinds of stuff that was going on. He served in the Vietnam War, and I honor and I respect that. But instead of giving those things up to God, you just kind of went down this direction. And still to this day, though he preaches the word of God, he still fights those demons of war. He fights those. But he doesn't understand the scars and the wounds that he placed upon his children. And so growing up, I had this false view of God because I viewed him and I put him in the package of my earthly father. God distorted. You see, God's love is unconditional. It's unconditional. He loves us. He loved us so much that he gave his only son. Who would do that? I love y'all, but I'm not giving my boy up for you. And guess what? You wouldn't give up your child for me either. And that's the way it should be. I mean, let's just be for real. God did it. He did it for us so that we don't have to. Right? Love factor number three. I'm going to close with this. Without love, none of this counts. We had a great service today, haven't we? The Spirit of God was moving in this place. I believe, in call me crazy, I believe that whenever we respond to God, he responds to us. Whenever we call upon him and we ask, I believe the very moment he calls upon, I'm just like this, I believe those things are broken. shackles. We sang it this morning. Rise, your shackles are no more. I believe this morning that when we respond to God, shackles are broken. Now it's up to us of whether we're going to put those things back on and put them on ourselves. That's another thing. But without love, even though the Spirit of God was moving in this place, without love, this means nothing. Oh, come on, Pastor. Ladies, I'm stealing your thunder. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's a wonderful class the ladies are doing. You're studying on Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock. You're studying what true love really is. 1 Corinthians 13, it says this. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but I don't have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging symbol. Did you hear that? If I don't have love, then this all I am. That's annoying. We laugh, but that's what the Word of God says we are. God doesn't give examples through the writers of the Word. He doesn't give examples just because he wants it to sound good. Everyone's got a saying. Everyone wants a good tweet to put on the internet. Can I tell you? When that is taken out of the element that it was intended to, that is annoying. But when John is up here playing, and yes, John, I'm talking to you. He's in the back right now. When John's playing that, and it's in rhythm, and it's in sync, it's a beautiful thing. But when we don't have love, that's annoying. And to be really honest, that's what the world is seeing, is just a bunch of nasty, cruddy, religious folks that don't give a rip about them, and all it is just a sound of annoyance. And they can't even hear the voice of the Spirit because you're too stinking loud and making a big fuss that they can't hear it. You see, without love, none of this counts. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all the mysteries and all the knowledge, and I have faith that can move mountains. Friends, I want all that. I want the gifts of the Spirit to be moving and flowing. I want it to be an ebb and flow. When He speaks, I respond. Michaela, I know that God uses you in different giftings. When we feel, we can feel God moving like that. But if we don't have love, I'm nothing. That moving mountains, that's talking about miracles. That's about pushing away the obstacles. That's talking about being moved by the power of God. What it's saying here, that there are people that don't have love that God still uses, but there's a time coming. Hello, everybody with me here this morning? Listen to verse 3. If I give all I possess to the poor, and give over my body to hardship that I may boast. Oh, look at me. And I see people like this all the time. Well, you know, God's really doing something awesome. The devil just came roughshod over me. And, you know, we give more glory to the devil than we do to God. Come on, give me a break. It's called false humility. Hello? But I don't have love, I gain nothing. And it gives you the attributes of love. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. Love is not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Love always protects. Love always trusts. Love always hopes. Love always perseveres. Love never fails. You see, without that, none of this even counts. Without love, none of this counts. Without love, Jesse can't lead. I've been trying to come up with a name for this. And Jesse and the goldfish, I don't know if that's working right, but right? we're working on that, right? But without love, listen, without love, it's nothing. Standing here preaching, without love, this is nothing. And where there is an absence of love, there will be a spirit of despair that comes forth from your mouth. Because the enemy will get a hold of that right there. And you're thinking you're being used by God, and you're really focused on your own agenda. Is it really the Holy Spirit telling you to point out someone's faults, or is it really something that's in your craw? And I don't even know what a craw is, but it's something in there. And you want to tell them rather than the Holy Spirit. You know, I tell you can disrupt the things of God, and you think it's all God, but it's really all you. This is where community and harmony with the Holy Spirit comes into play. You see, without love, in a paraphrase, without love, we're only making noise. Without love, we're worthless. And without love, we're not going anywhere. That's a paraphrase of the scriptures. John chapter 2, and I'm going to close with this. I'm writing to remind you, dear friends, because clearly he's talked to them about this before. I'm writing to remind you about this, dear friends, that we should love one another. This is not a new commandment, but one we have had from the beginning. Love means doing what God has commanded us to do. And he has commanded us to love one another, just as you heard from the beginning. This is nothing new. Christ gave himself up for us because he loved us. So why is it so hard to love somebody across the aisle from us? You think people got on Jesus' nerves? Let me rephrase that. Do you think you get on God's nerves? Because I can tell you right now, I think I'm one of the first on the hit list. I run around worrying. I drove around just this past week looking for a building, driving around aimlessly. I have no clue. I'm just driving up and down industrial parks, driving all around, praying in the Holy Spirit. Lord, show us where we're supposed to go. Show us what we're supposed to do. And I kind of think I get on his nerves sometimes. Because all I get is, do you trust me? Are you going to trust me? Well, yeah, God, I'll sure. Just tell me what you're up to and I'll trust you. Come on, give me a little something. Right? You know, we get a little frisky with God and he just says, homie, don't play that. Right? Sit down and let my love wash over you. You see, what we need is a dose of Jesus that we become addicted to. Addicted to his love, addicted to his mercy, drawn in by his Spirit, that we are never, ever the same again. You see, there's where the love factor comes in. It's unconditional. It's always moving. But without it, this means nothing. So where's your love level? And I'm not talking about Valentine's Day. Where's the love level? When God comes calling, oh, I heard my lover at the door, and my heart began to jump. Are you going to jump up immediately and unlock the door and let him in, or are you going to stay and give excuses? Should I get and put my robe on? Do I really need to soil my feet again? God, I got some stuff I got to do. Can I take a rain check on you, God? Can I put a save the date down? Can we reschedule this? No, when God comes calling, we've got to respond. Because God's ultimate goal is to show you his love that you've never experienced before. We think we know what love is. Can I tell you, the love of God is greater far than any tongue can tell or pen can even write down. Amen? You bow your heads and close your eyes this morning. Before we go on, let me ask you this. Is there anyone here that you would say, Pastor, before we go on, I got to get things right with Christ? Maybe you have given your life to Christ before, or maybe now you find yourself in a position to where you've been in church all your life and you've never asked Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Either way, it's called a fresh start. If you're here today and you would like to give your life to Christ, or you would like to make your life right with him this very moment because you sense him calling, if that's you, just slip your hand up in the air and say, you know what, Pastor, pray with me today. That's me. Anybody. Anybody. This is the time. This is the time to respond. God bless you, son. This is the time. I want to get things right with the Lord. If you're in the back and you're watching on closed circuit television, I want you to respond to this. Just come in those back doors and I'll see you. This is the time. Anyone here, you want to make things right. Maybe you're here and you're trying to live for God, but you're living in sin. You know you are living in sin. You're doing things that are not according to God's word, and you feel as if you're riding the line. You're pushing the envelope. Today, right now, is for you. It's to reconsecrate your heart, reposition yourself to where you're in line to serve God. If that's you here today, please respond. Just raise your hand real quick. I'm not going to embarrass anybody. That's me. God bless you, honey. We've got teenagers that are so sweet and so sensitive to the Lord. Kids that have raised their hand before, and can I tell you, I love that. I was that kid. Every time the altar came, I was just making sure. I always want that to happen. But I also want us to grow in Christ to understand his grace and his mercy as well. Anybody else? Can we pray this prayer together? Father in heaven, I come to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. And I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. And I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. This moment, I am a child of God. This moment, I'm a believer. This moment, if Christ should return, I will be in heaven with him. I stand upon God's word and I turn away from sin. I repent of it. I give it to you. Now be Lord of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's always good to just be sure. It's okay.